Awesome. It's a real honor and a privilege to be able to share. I've never done it in this church yet. And yeah, it's so cool. It really is. And it's a real blessing, because when you're seeking God, you know, you're like, God, what do you want to talk about? And that takes you so deep. And there's this big bright light that shines in your eyes when you're here. It helps you guys out, I'm sure. For people who still turn in their Bibles somewhere or take notes, I'm going to be floating around Matthew 9, verse 35 to 38. And so I'm not like Brother Don. Brother Don is amazing. He has amazing notes. Even on like the men's Bible study nights, he's got like a novel. I don't do notes. I find it hard enough to read, let alone try and write. And then if I do take notes, I get lost in them. So I've got a couple of scriptures. So we'll see where we go. And what I felt to share about, what I felt God lead me into, was the heart of the gospel. And I don't know about you guys, but I love the heart stuff. I love it. And I think we as Pentecostals maybe don't have the best heart connection that there can be. I don't know about you guys, when I first started in faith, I was very much answer focused, like, you know, yes and amen, and just pressing in, and it was good. It produced results. But there's a part of the human and a part of God where his heart is such a big thing. You know, and we'll find that the entire gospel is a message about the heart. You see, Jesus even said that you worship me with your lips, but your heart is far from me. He cares about the heart so much. And so as I was reading this, I really caught something about God's heart. So, starting from verse 35, and I'm reading from the Amplified, which is good. I like it. It's hard to read out of because there's so many extra words, but that's okay. So, and Jesus went about all the cities and villages, teaching in their synagogues and proclaiming the good news, the gospel of the kingdom, and curing all kinds of diseases and every weakness and infirmity. First off, how good is Jesus? All right, this is his heart. Everywhere he went, he proclaimed the good news of the gospel of the kingdom of God. And that looks like something. It was curing all kinds of diseases, epilepsy included, praise the Lord, and healing all kinds of diseases, every weakness and infirmity. Every. Come on. So good. And when he saw the throngs, all right, I don't know what a throng is, but I'm pretty sure it's like a big group of people, okay? He was moved with pity and sympathy for them. I think the King James says compassion. So he saw like these massive amounts of people. He was there, and pretty much everywhere he went, he's healing, sharing God's goodness with them, just blessing them, you know, not condemning them or anything, just setting them free. And then he saw this massive group of people, and he was moved. His heart just went out because they were bewildered. Right, the Amplified says that they were harassed and distressed and dejected and helpless, like sheep without a shepherd. Then he said to his disciples, right, the guys that were following him, the harvest indeed is plentiful, but the laborers are few. So pray to the Lord of the harvest to force out and thrust out laborers into his harvest. Now, we can read over a lot of stuff. You know, we can just read that like that. But when you think of it, you really catch the heart of Jesus in it. So Jesus is doing this thing, and he's, you know, I love how, has anyone seen The Chosen? It's so good. Yeah? Have you seen The Chosen? You got to check it out, man. It's wild. I was not going to watch it because a lot of Christian movies are kind of corny, but this is really good. It's really well done. And it shows, there's this one scene, I can't remember what episode it was, but all the disciples are bickering about stuff, as they did, and Jesus has been out all day and it's like late at night, and he's just laying hands and setting people free continually. And they're all arguing about like who's the greatest, what's going on. And he comes back and he's tired, you know, he was wrecked. And he's like, good night, everybody. And just went to bed, and his mum went and packed him in, and I'm just there crying like, oh, Jesus, you know. And but this, what he says to his disciples is huge. You just picture God himself, okay? He knows what he's going to do, because people have been stuck in bondage and pain and diseases and sickness and sin for ages, and they were living in darkness. And now Jesus comes. He's like the light, okay? So he's doing this stuff. He's got his eyes set like a flint, Isaiah says. And he says to the guys that are with him, man, this is huge. You know, there is so much work. And it's not like I'm going to be knackered at the end of this. I think it's just like, this is too big for me to do by myself. Imagine that. Imagine God in the flesh saying that. I remember we had, what was his name? David Reeves. I think he was here and he was doing the presbytery, and it was when Becker and Chris were here, and he called Chris Batman, called me Superman. It was funny. And he it was really good. But he said this thing at the start of it when he called me and Melissa up, and he said, Chris and Melissa, he said, come forth, the Lord has need of thee. Yeah, he did. And I've still got the recording, and I'd stop it and then I'd rewind it and I'd just listen to that bit. Chris and Melissa, come forth, God has need of thee. Chris and Melissa, come forth, God has need of thee. And it is amazing fact to think that God has need of us. He really does. You know? And, man. And I went to this, who went to the Awakening? The Awakening Australia, I think it was, how many years ago? Yeah, a while ago. And I went to this evangelism one. And I thought I was going to learn like some cool tips or tricks or something. Anyway, he didn't talk about anything to do with evangelism. He talked about worship and our love for God. And he said, evangelism happens when our love for God, when our worship flows over into the streets. You know, and it's so true. And I was just wondering, like, we need to pray for that love. We need to be proper praying for God to transform our lives, transform our hearts, till we see people like he did. So Jesus saw the throngs and he was moved. He was moved. I like that. How many of us get overwhelmed by like how big the world's problems can be? It's so easy to just find a bucket of sand and then just... It really is. It's huge. But I love what Jesus did. He was moved. You know, there's that saying, and it's like, we can't help everyone. Like, some people write that off as an excuse. You know, they go, well, you can't help everyone. Jesus didn't save everyone. He didn't heal everyone, whatever. But we can't let that stop us from helping someone, can we? You know, I love Heidi Baker. Heidi Baker's got this ministry which is, like, ridiculous. It's huge. And she does this conference, and it's called Stopping for the One. How good is that? That's easy. We can stop for one person, can't we? You know? And it's amazing. I remember when, after I went to India, and after the Awakening with Neville and Dee, and I just saw the radicalness of their faith in India, you know? One thing that happened over there, it was amazing. We saw so many miracles. Heaps. Heaps and heaps and heaps. It was so good. But it really had me crying and praying for us back in Australia, because they do faith different to us. You know, their culture is very spiritual. It's very understanding of that reality and honoring that, because they know the effect that the spiritual has on the natural. Whereas us in Australia, we're just like, meh. Like, that's our normal culture. And I was crying and praying for us, asking for forgiveness, for lukewarmness, for all kinds of stuff. But on the way, when I came back, I started praying and I was like, Jesus, man, I want to make disciples for you. You know, I want to do it like how they do it. They like set people free, and those people get on fire and start following Jesus, and it just makes sense, you know. It's good. And God sent me someone. He sent me this guy, and it was at a dads and kids class, which I was not excited to go to. I didn't want to, right? One, the thought of having two kids with me alone scared me. It did. You know, it was scary. But anyway, God sent me this dude. I met this other dad there. He had a whole heap of stuff. He was covered in tattoos. He was missing a heap of teeth. His eye was pointing over there. You know, like he was rough as guts. Like, I liked him. But he was really struggling with anxiety. And he was like, he said to the leader guy that I want to start learning about prayer. Maybe that will help me. And the leader guy said, well, look, I don't know anything about it, but I'm pretty sure Chris does. So go and see him. And I caught up with him and I started talking about, well, let's talk about the one you're going to pray to. You know, let's not get into the how-tos. Let's talk about the heart of God. And I got to share the gospel with him and got to pray for him. His neck got healed. His back got healed. His eye, he couldn't see out of it before, but after I prayed for him, he started to be able to see out of it. So it messed him up even. Yeah, he was. He was like this, like one eye was there, one eye was over there. And he started to be able to see out of it. And so it was like, dude, I'm getting blown out. You know, he was freaked out. It was awesome. And anyway, it was so good. And the whole reason I'm sharing this is because God will, if we pray for something, and if it's according to his will, and if our heart doesn't condemn us, you know, in 1 John it says that then we will have the things that we pray for. And so we have this amazing mission field called Kingston. It's huge, you know. Like in this one here, Luke 19, 41 to 44, it says, when Jesus caught sight of the city, he burst into tears with uncontrollable weeping over Jerusalem, saying, if you could recognize this day, peace is within your reach, but you can't see it. I, just as a confession, I haven't done that over Kingston. And I think that there's a call to connect with God's heart where there's a place where we do, you know, where we look at our family that maybe aren't walking with God and instead of praying for them so that they change, so that it's easier for us to live with them, we pray for them to know him deeper, you know. It's so good. I love how Neville says, you know, he always says like, when he says, pray to the Lord of the harvest to force out laborers, he says, if you start praying that, God's probably going to send you. And that might be why we don't pray it too often, I don't know. But in all honesty, when we go, then we encounter God. We see him. Because that's where he is. That's where his heart is. He's here, don't get me wrong. He's within you, he's within me, wherever two or three are gathered, he's there. But you see him more and more for some reason, I don't know why, but we see him more and more when we go out. He just loves to reveal himself to people. I got this other scripture, 1 Thessalonians chapter 1, verse 4 to 10. And now I'm reading out of the Passion. I changed around. It says, dear brothers and sisters, you are so dearly loved by God, and we know that he has chosen you to be his very own. Isn't that good? I find comfort in that. I remember one time. It turns out there's no appropriate place to pause when having a drink of water. It's just going to happen. I remember one time we were, I think it was Opa. He hurt his back, or I think it might have been a kidney or something, I'm not sure. But I'm pretty sure he was sitting where Lyle was sitting. And Josiah was in the sound desk, and Orma came and told me, so we went and prayed and laid hands. And it was during worship, and And it didn't look like there was any change because he's still sitting down. I'm pretty sure he even had to leave early. You know, he was in a lot of pain. And I remember just praying. I'm like getting frustrated, like, oh, God, when are we going to see some of this stuff? You know, and we've already seen amazing miracles, but it's just that carnal nature. You know, you always come back to that same place of doubt and unbelief. It's inherent in the flesh, you know. So, but he said to me, he said, can you trust me? Can you trust me beyond what you're seeing? I was like, okay. So I went back to worshiping. And probably heaps of people prayed. No one likes seeing people in pain. And the next day, it was Monday, and I'm just cleaning up the yard, and Orma called me. And she said, oh, Chris, I just wanted to tell you that Opa's back was all better the next day. He cancelled his doctor's appointment and went and played golf. You know, amazing. Yeah, it was so good. And I was like, oh, awesome. So I called Josiah, and I was like, bro, you know, we prayed for Opa yesterday. Da-da-da-da-da-da. And he's like, oh, awesome. And then my very next thought went to, I wonder how many people, like, don't know that you can do that. I wonder how many people don't know that you can connect with God. That he is forever there with his arms open waiting to receive them. You know? And then I was reminded of Romans. And Romans is like, I didn't save it. But it talks about, like, how are people going to connect with him if they've never heard about him? Or maybe they've heard about him, but they don't know that he wants to connect with them, you know? And then he goes like, and how is anyone going to hear about him unless someone shares it? And then he goes, how is anyone going to share it unless they're sent? Hey? In Jesus' name, I send you to your family and your community to share the gospel, to share the love of God. We've all been commissioned, yeah? Yeah, and it's not always fun. This is why God does the heart stuff. When I came back from Adelaide last time, my mum blew up at me something chronic. Hope she doesn't watch this. I love you. But it was just a real out of the thing, and I was not happy with her. It was completely unrationalized. But anyway, and I wanted to try and bridge that gap and talk about it, and it was just met with brick walls. And I'm like, okay, whatever. It's your choice. And then someone posted something on Mother's Day on Facebook, and it was like, love your mother. And I know the scripture that says, honor your mother and father. I know it, right? I get it. And I was like, ugh. It's a post on Mother's Day. Happy Mother's Day. Love you. She's like, thank you, darling. You know, not even considering all the crap that I'm stewing on. Anyway, so I got over it. But so God works. He has to work in our hearts. We have to pray this stuff. We have to go there. The Bible says in 1 John, it says, well, in John 15, it says that if you abide in me and my words abide in you, then you'll ask whatever and it'll be done, right? Amazing scripture, amazing promises. We often claim it. In 1 John, it says that if we say that we abide in Christ, then we ought to walk just as Christ walked, right? And it says in Philippians 2, you know, let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God, didn't consider it robbery to be equal with him, but made himself of no reputation and made himself obedient. You know, he went. And that's I feel that call for us, you know, for me as well. Like, I'm a big believer and a big fan of what Bill Johnson says. He says, if it feeds me, it will feed them. And so I pretty much just share whatever God's talking to me about. So there's one more scripture. And it occurred that as they were going along the road, this is in Luke 9:57-62, back in the Amplified. Thank you for your patience as we jump everywhere. A man said to him, Lord, I'll follow you wherever you go. Verse 58, and Jesus told him, foxes have lurking holes and the birds of the air have roosts and nests, but the Son of Man has no place to lay his head. 59, and he said to another, become my disciple, side with my party, accompany me. But he replied, Lord, permit me first to go and bury and await the death of my father. But Jesus said to him, allow the dead to bury their own dead, but as for you, go and publish abroad throughout all the regions the kingdom of God. And that's a big thing. I think in today's church and in our walks, we often want to know what God's call for our life is. And I think that's all well and good. But there's one universal call in Christ, and that's to follow him. Just as he walked, share the gospel, proclaim the good news of the kingdom, become an ambassador of hope. Amen, Omar? Come on. That's who we are. You know, all right. Brilliant question. When we get around each other, other Christians, maybe people like not Christians, what are we normally talking about? Are we talking about the gospel, the kingdom, the amazing way that God is going to transform the situations because we give it to him in prayer? Or are we talking about how dark, how gloomy, all this stuff? You know, what are we ambassadors of? You know, when all we do is talk about negative, we actually become like an ambassador of Satan. The name Satan is accuser of the brethren, especially if we're gossiping. You know, it's huge. So when we come together, Jesus says, like, but he said to you, allow the dead to bury the dead, but you go throughout all the regions and preach the gospel of the kingdom of God. And he said, another also said, I'll follow you, Lord, to become your disciple. Let me say goodbye to those that are at my home. Jesus said to him, no one who puts his hand to the plow and looks back to the things behind is fit for the kingdom. And the good thing is that if we find that we've been people that have looked back and our heart is at war with that, we can just repent and we can ask God to transform us. You know, we can ask him for a spirit of obedience. It's in the Bible. He can give us a spirit of obedience. And God transformed hearts in Exodus. You remember? Let my people go. God hardened his heart so that he could show himself strong. God can play chess with people's hearts. It's a thing. We just need to come to him. There's so much value in offering our stuff up to Jesus. So good. So today's going to be the shortest message that you've heard this year, maybe, because I've gone through all my scriptures. But I want to do something, and it's fun. It is fun. I want us to break off into small groups. I'm going to say three people. Okay? Three people per group. And here's the thing. The Bible says that if you water, you yourself will be watered. Okay? And there's so much in every person in here, in Christ. The Bible says the fullness of God dwells in you. Have you ever stopped to think about what that looks like? The fullness of God dwells in you. I don't have a grid for it. You know what I mean? The fullness of God. You know, God can speak into a situation and there can be absolutely no reason for change and there can be complete change. He made light without a sun in Genesis 1. He made light and then 3 days later he made a sun. But before he made the sun, light was already there because he spoke it. And God wants to speak some stuff into each one of us and through each one of us. So when we break off into small groups, I want us to, each person, share what inhibition there might be in advancing the kingdom. And I don't mean about being more busy. I mean about it coming from a place of rest, just flowing out of your heart. Now, one inhibition might be that you haven't encountered it. And that's okay, because there's two other people that are going to pray for you to encounter it. Another inhibition might be, I get so scared. You know, that's okay. Two people are going to pray. Another one might be, I don't know how. We're going to pray. We're going to offer things up to Jesus and watch what he does with them. Because God is going to transform lives. It's what he does. He's going to transform this community. It's what he wants to do. Yeah? Okay, so for those who can stand easier, let's go. Groups of three people. This is fun.